I also should have mentioned that we are intending to record this webinar today. We will be placing the re recording onto our website to assist people who weren't able to make the session. The Commission is jointly funded by the Australian Government and by state and territory governments, and with responsibility for oversight of safety and quality in healthcare across the country. We work in partnerships with patients, consumers, carers, clinicians, managers, policymakers, and healthcare organisations to achieve a sustainable, safe, and high-quality health system. We have extensive experience in the development of national standards for healthcare settings. Many of you would be familiar with a range of standards and products that the Commission puts out, with the intent of driving better outcomes and ensuring that we have appropriate governance and involvement of consumers and carers in the healthcare system in Australia. We are seeking feedback from you as part of this consultation on the draft National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for Community Managed Organisations. That document was released earlier in the week. I anticipate many of you may not have had an opportunity to go through it in terrific detail. I will provide you with an oversight of the content throughout this presentation to assist your thinking. You have plenty of time to read it and get thoughts back to us. The consultation period is open until after Christmas. We'll be closing it on Friday, the 21st of January. And thus, we really do encourage you to read the document and provide us with your thoughts. We're very keen to get them. We also intend to have a number of focus groups. They will begin next week. They will run through the period till mid-December, and then we'll also have an extra focus group in January, and perhaps a second one, depending on demand, to give people the opportunity to provide us with interactive feedback on the standards. We would certainly encourage you to have read the standards before you attend a focus group. We do intend to get down to some of the detail. We're very keen to get the detail correct. As you can understand, with standards, the detail is very important. You also have the opportunity to provide written feedback. We're very, very keen to get written feedback, and you can provide that through the Commission's portal or direct to Rebecca. We're very keen to make sure that the development of the standards is shaped in the way that's most appropriate for the sector, for consumers and carers, and for all of those involved in the regulation of the system. We're intending the standards to be finalised and published next year, and then there'll be a short period after that while we work through the implementation arrangements, and the standards ought to be available for utilisation in early 2023. It's probably important at this point to articulate our intentions with regards to what community managed organisation is, and thus the scope of the application of the standards. I'm sure there are many of you online who are interested in that. We received a number of queries leading up to today to ensure that that was clarified. So the community managed sector, for the purposes of this consultation, is made up of mostly non-government, not-for-profit organisations that provide community-based services to keep people well in the community. Mental health CMOs provide services such as psychosocial rehabilitation, helpline and counselling services, subacute step-up, step-down services, accommodation support, self-help and peer support, employment, education, and family and carer support. Those services can be general or they can be targeted to specific groups. Community services provided by local health districts or local health network services do not fit within the definition of a CMO, and we're not intending these particular standards to apply to those organisations. They will continue to be subject to the National Safety and Quality Health Service standards as they are currently. Just to talk a little bit about the development of the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs. They remain aligned to the structure and intent of the National Safety and Quality Health Service standards and focus on the key themes from those standards, which are very centred on embedding consumer-centred care and governance in the provision of care services to individuals. They closely mirror the structure used for the National Safety and Quality Digital Mental Health Standards, to ensure obviously consistency and where required interoperability. They've been drafted based on feedback received in the preliminary consultation held earlier in this year, and I recognise there are likely a number of people online who participated in that process. We ran a number of focus groups between April and June, and we received very helpful feedback from the groups that participated in that process, and the standards reflect the feedback from those groups. And we hope that you can see your thoughts reflected in the standards And indeed, if we haven't quite got those thoughts correct, we're more than happy to hear from you to how we can perhaps get them honed in the way that you'd like them to be. We've mapped the standards against the National Safety and Quality Health Service standards, the National Safety and Quality Digital Mental Health standards, the National Safety and Quality Primary and Community Healthcare standards, the NDIS practice standards, and the National Standards for Mental Health Services. We've tried to ensure that we've incorporated all the relevant concepts to make sure that there's appropriate interoperability, and where necessary, we can get the least regulatory burden on services by being able to get mutual recognition across different sets of standards. The National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs will provide a streamlined, sustainable, and single set of standards against which services can be accredited. They will form part of the suite of standards developed by the Commission. I've referenced a number of those other sets of standards in the last slide, and as I said, I'm sure many of you are familiar with the various sets of standards that the Commission produces. The National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs have three predominant standards. Underneath those, there are 13 criteria, and then there are 92 actions that support those 13 criteria. I will give you shortly a map of those particular concepts so you can see many of the issues that were raised by a lot of you via our first consultation process and those issues that were felt important in much of the written feedback that we received. They apply at the service provider level. And they state what is required, but not how it must be done. And this is consistent with the way that the Commission approaches all of its work around standards. It lets the organisation determine how to respond to the need for the standard, and that can vary based on the size of the organisation and the scope of the services that it provides. So, what are the three standards that are visible within the National and Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs? The three standards are the Practice Governance Standard, the Partnering with Consumers, Families and Carers Standard, and the Model of Care Standard. And briefly, I'll talk about each of those standards and provide you with the underlying criteria and items that map to each of those three standards. Each standard contains a description of the standard, a statement of the intent that standard's designed to achieve, a list of the criteria that describe the key areas covered by that standard, explanatory notes on the content of the standard, item headings for groups of actions in each criterion that are related to each other and therefore are attempting to achieve the same outcome, and then actions that describe what is required to meet the standard. Often the heaviest focus is on the actions. It's the actions that are measured. And the other issues around the criteria and the items provide the conceptual framework that hold the actions together. But it's often the actions that are measured and therefore garner the greatest attention when reviewing the standards. So briefly, the Practice Governance Standard, and you'll see across the top of my screen here the four criteria that make up the Practice Governance Standard. They are practice governance, leadership and culture, safety and quality systems, workforce qualifications and skills, and a safe environment. Underneath each of those, you'll see on the screen a list of items that are subsets of those criteria. For each of those items, there may be one or perhaps multiple actions that apply, to achieving and measuring and meeting those particular items. You can see under practice governance, leadership and culture, there are two items that make up that particular criteria. Practice governance, leadership and culture as an item, and care leadership. For each of those, there are actions that sit underneath them that assist accrediting agencies to assess an organization and determine if they're able to meet those criteria. You'll see under safety and quality systems, there are six items that sit underneath that criteria. The first being legislation, regulations, and policies and procedures. The second, measurement and quality improvement. The third, risk management. The fourth, incident management systems and open disclosure. The fifth, feedback and complaints management and resolution. And the sixth, consumer care records and information. Similarly, with workforce qualifications and skills, there are two items that sit underneath that criteria: safety and quality training, workforce qualifications, and performance management. And finally, the safe environment criteria includes an item on safe environment and an item on privacy to ensure that people operating both as members of the workforce for a service, but also for consumers and carers and families, that the environment the service is operating within is a safe one. The second standard is the partnering with consumers, families and carers standard. And you'll see here that there are three criteria that make up that particular standard. Unsurprisingly, partnering with consumers in their own care is one of those criteria. Health literacy is a second criteria, and partnering with consumers, families and carers in design and governance is the third criteria. Some of you will note that there's likely to be overlap between some of the themes, the concepts of design and governance appearing here in the criteria under partnering with consumers, families and carers, obviously has some overlap with the concept of practice governance. If I work through the three criteria here underneath this particular standard, you'll see in partnering with consumers in their own care, there are three items that sit underneath that particular criteria. The first is rights. The second is informed consent. And the third is supported decision-making and planning of care. Under the second criteria of health literacy, there are two items: communication that supports effective partnerships, and accessing healthcare service information. And then under the third criteria of partnering with consumers, families and carers in design and governance, there are two items: partnerships in governance, planning, design, measurement and evaluation, and promotion and prevention. As I indicated on the earlier slide, for each of these, there are one or perhaps multiple actions that allow accrediting agencies to assess if an organisation meets these criteria. Now, I recognise this slide is a little bit busy, and it's fair to say that the model of care standard is probably the most complex of the three standards and contains the most actions. I'll work through this as systematically as I can to assist you to understand what's intended in the actions. And I do that largely because I recognise that many of you probably haven't had the opportunity to read the document in full at this point. And the intention today, while I recognise reading these out may not be the most entertaining form of information dissemination, it's important that you do understand the actions that sit within these particular standards. So there are, as you see across the screen, six criteria that make up the model of care standard. The first is establishing the model of care. The second, delivering the model of care. The third, recognising and responding to acute deterioration and minimising harm. The fourth is communicating for safety. The fifth, infection prevention and control systems. And the sixth is medication safety. Like in the previous screens, there are a number of items that sit underneath each of those criteria. Looking at the establishing the model of care criteria, there are four items. The first being designing the model of care. The second, evidence supporting the model of care. The third, planning for delivery. And the fourth, access and entry. Under the delivering the model of care criteria, there are again four items: screening and assessment, developing the comprehensive care plan, continuity of care, and integration of care. Underneath the recognising and responding to acute deterioration and minimising harm criteria, you can see there are a number of items. In total, there are 10. The first, recognising acute deterioration, and the second, responding to deterioration. The third, escalating care. The fourth, predicting, preventing and managing self-harm and suicide. The fifth, predicting, preventing and managing aggression and violence. The sixth, eliminating and minimising restrictive practices. The seventh, preventing delirium and managing cognitive impairment. The eighth, preventing and managing pressure injuries. The ninth, preventing falls and harm from falls. And the tenth, nutrition and hydration. The fourth criteria, communicating for safety, has four items: correct identification, communication to support consumer referral and collaborative integration, communication of critical information, and documentation of information. The fifth criteria, infection prevention and control systems, has again four items: standard and transmissions-based precautions, documentation of information, workforce screening and immunisation, and to antimicrobial stewardship. And the final criteria, medication safety, has three criteria. The first being medicine scope of practice, the second documentation provision and access to medicines related information, and the third safe and secure storage and distribution of medicines. So, without going through all of the individual actions, it's important to identify that there are 92 actions within the standards. The Practice Governance Standard contains 38 actions. The Partnering with Consumers, Family and Carers Standard contains 15 actions. And the Model of Care Standard contains 39 actions. Not all actions will necessarily apply to all organisations. As I stated earlier, it depends on the size and scale of the organisation and the scope of practice of the organisation. Probably important to talk a little bit now about how a community managed organisation might approach the standards and in dealing with the need to have themselves assessed against the standards or to meet those standards as time goes by. The first step is obviously getting to know the standards, and partly that's my intention today. I hope you'll have more time to do so after today and participate in our focus groups and give us further guidance on these standards. Community managed organisations that provide mental health services should familiarise themselves with the actions in the standards and how they will be applied in their service. You may wish to identify actions that may not be applicable to your particular service. Step two, then, an organisation would work through individual actions in the standards. Implementation of the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs will vary depending on the size and context of the service, as well as the types of services delivered. For each applicable action, the community managed organisation should consider whether its current way of working, policies, training and involvement of consumers and carers demonstrate achievement of the action in practice. Community managed organisations should consider any changes needed in order to meet the requirements of the specific action. Documentation from these quality improvement activities becomes evidence of changes being introduced. Then the third step would be to undertake continuous quality improvement activities. Once the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs have been implemented, the community managed organisation should continue to use the processes and systems within the standards when delivering care. Services should conduct regular self-assessments of their safety and quality systems and monitor care and outcomes to identify areas that would benefit from quality improvement activities. This includes reviewing ways of working, policies and procedures, incident reports, best practice guidelines, and the setting where mental health services are delivered. And the Commission will develop resources to assist community managed organisations with this process. Those of you who are familiar with many of our other sets of standards, the production of resources are a central part of what we do in implementing standards to ensure that organisations have the best possible supports in putting these into practice. Just to talk briefly about our intentions with regards to implementation, the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for community managed organisations will not be mandatory. Community managed organisations may choose to implement them voluntarily. However, it is likely that funders may choose to use them as evidence of the quality of the service, and they may make it a contractual requirement in a funding agreement. That is possible. Not all actions in the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs will apply to all community managed organisation mental health service providers. For example, if there is a standard in actions relating to medication safety, these would not be applicable in a service that does not prescribe, supply and or administer medicines. Any such actions are deemed not applicable for that organisation and are not assessed. I'm sure many of you are familiar with accreditation, but I thought it important just to briefly reference what it is. Yeah, it is a process in which trained external reviewers assess a service's implementation of a set of standards. Those assessors seek evidence that actions contained in the standards have been implemented. An assessment against the standards and the awarding of accreditation status provides assurance to the community that a community managed organisation's mental health service has the safety and quality systems and processes in place to meet the expected standards of care. I want to talk briefly about mutual recognition. recognizing the importance of minimizing the regulatory burden on service providers who are attempting to meet accreditation against multiple sets of standards. Mutual recognition is an agreement between regulatory bodies whereby accreditation against one set of standards, for example, the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs, can be recognized as equating to accreditation against another set or sets of standards, such as the National Standards for Mental Health Services or the National Disability Insurance Scheme Practice Standards. This equivalency may be automatic or conditional and complete or could be partial. This reduces the need for a community managed organisation to be accredited against multiple sets of standards. The Commission will be working with a range of regulatory bodies to move forward a mutual recognition approach with those regulatory bodies to reduce the regulatory burden on service providers going forward. I just want to talk to you about a few key questions that we have for the consultation to help guide your thinking if you are intending to make a written submission or if you are intending to participate in any of our forums. These are some of the questions we think might be pertinent. It doesn't mean you have to limit yourself to these questions. You may choose to obviously select other issues that you want to feedback to us on. That's absolutely fine. But here are a few questions that we think may be worthwhile of consideration. What did you think of the draft standards? How could they be improved if there were things you feel could be improved? As a community mental health service provider, do you see yourselves using them? Are the key themes in the standards the right ones? Partnering with consumers, families and carers, governance and systems, and delivering on an evidence-based model of care. Are they the key things that we need to be focusing on? Do the actions appear relevant to you? And in particular, if there are actions that don't appear relevant to you, is that a function of the sort of the scope of your service, or do you think they're not relevant to the CMO sector in general? Have we left anything out that's important? Are there actions that we could add to the standards that would actually improve their capacity to give and deliver better outcomes for the community? Are there actions we could take out that are no longer necessary? And are they written in an effective way? Particularly, is the terminology pitched appropriately? We received a tremendous amount of feedback in our first consultation process around some of the difficulties with getting the terminology correct. We're very keen to hear if we've done the best we could with a difficult set of parameters for getting that terminology correct. And again, what sort of resources would be helpful to services implementing the standards? What sort of things would allow you to feel confident that you were able to tackle the accreditation process and ensure that you came out of that process feeling confident about the services that you met, that you provide, and that they met those standards? We'd be very keen for you to share the details of this webinar with your friends and colleagues. We've got up on the screen the email inbox that you can provide written submissions to, which is mentalhealth@safetyandquality.gov.au. And you'll see also our URL, our web address, where you can get further information on the standards, which is www.safetyandquality.gov.au/our-work/mental-health. We're also very keen for you to interrogate the material available on the URL. I might just briefly check in with Andrew and see if we've had any queries come up on the chat that perhaps I can address in the remaining time that we have.
Thanks, David. I'll get to the knottier questions in a minute. We've had a couple of requests for PowerPoint slides to be circulated, and we'll do that after the webinar today. The first question comes from Leanne Craze, and that is, do these standards replace the National Mental Health Standards, or the old National Standards for Mental Health Services? And will services be required to, my chat's going funny. Will services be required to be accredited to both? How will it work?
Okay. Thanks, Andrew, and thanks, Leanne. So it's important to say that the Commission has no authority over the National Standards for Mental Health Services. And in fact, one of the issues we've had to address as part of this process, and in fact in our earlier consultation, is that nobody has authority for the National Standards for Mental Health Services. They don't actually have an owner. And therefore, we can't commit one way or the other to what might happen with the National Standards for Mental Health Services in terms of their review process, or indeed what might happen in terms of the regulatory process associated with them going forward. What I would say is that we've developed these standards with a view to them providing a credible alternative to the National Standards for Mental Health Services. The Commission is not a regulatory body itself. Regulatory bodies are obviously the states and territories and the Commonwealth Government in terms of the departments that provide oversight of the implementation of standards. They may choose to use these standards, they may choose to continue using the National Standards for Mental Health Services. But it's our intention to provide a credible alternative and also, as I said earlier in the presentation, to work towards mutual recognition such that if somebody is accredited to one set of standards, it is recognised as efficient accreditation against one of the other sets of standards. Sorry, Andrew, what was the second part of the question?
How would it work? And I think you've sort of answered that we don't know yet.
No, indeed.
It's not for us to set.
Just while I'm on that particular theme, what I would say is that the Commission has the opportunity, because it has a special statutory responsibility for the development and implementation of standards, we have the capacity to monitor the implementation of the standards, to review that implementation and to improve those standards over time. And we can do that relatively efficiently and quickly. The benefit of the Commission being involved in developing these standards is that we can ensure that the standards remain contemporary going forward. And one of the difficulties, as many of you would know, that the National Standards for Mental Health Services are now 11 years old, and one of the struggles is keeping them contemporary to what we all think is important in terms of delivery of mental health care. Other queries, Andrew?
Yep. So Bill Guy from Community Mental Health Australia has asked, it would be good to know the differences between this set of standards for community managed organisations and the other standards. I'm presuming, Bill, you mean the National Safety Quality Health Service standards, which apply for mental health services, for instance, in public and private hospitals and community services provided by local health districts and local health networks. So Bill's interested in what got included in the CMO standard and what hasn't been included.
Thanks, Andrew. So Bill, it's important to say that the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs still reflect the fundamental structure of the National Safety and Quality Health Service standards. Many of the important themes from those standards are visible in the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs. There are, of course, though, some standards from the National Safety and Quality Health Service standards which just don't have applicability in a CMO setting. The obvious one would be, say, the blood management standard, which is specifically designed for acute service provision in the hospital sector. So what the process the team went through was to vet the National Safety and Quality Health Service standards and indeed a range of other standards, as I listed earlier in the presentation, and to make an assessment whether each of those particular actions from those standards were relevant for the service provision in the CMO sector. We've given in as part of this consultation, the document that we've released is our views on those actions that are most applicable to the CMO sector within the scope that I described right at the start of the presentation. Of course, we are seeking feedback to assess whether we've got that right, Bill. But in short, we went through the process of looking at the National Safety and Quality Health Service standards, made an assessment as to whether each of the actions in there was applicable for the CMO sector, and if so, we incorporated them into this particular document. Andrew?
I might just add some of the other differences are around language. So, the health standards still tend to use the term patient. The National Safety Quality Health Service standards also use the term clinician a lot. And we've changed those to reflect the kinds of language that are much more commonly used.
Thanks, Andrew.
We have another question from Tracy Janto. I'm hoping I pronounced your name right. As some CMOs have people with lived experience as part of their decision-making body and in the interests of health literacy, Would you consider publishing these standards for review in easy English, even easy?
I missed the last part of what you had to say there, Andrew, but I think I got the general tenet of it.
So, would we do an easy English or an easy version?
Yeah. So, Tracy, obviously the intention is to ensure that the standards are understood, and not only understood but accessible by everybody who might have a need to utilise them. The language of the individual standards themselves obviously needs to remain consistent for the purposes of the assessment process, but the Commission will develop a range of resources and tools to assist those people who are implementing the standards to best understand how those standards are applied in their setting and to understand the intention that underlies those standards. That includes assessment and information that allows consumers and carers to understand what we mean by partnering in terms of governance, the sort of supports that are necessarily required to make that happen effectively, and also information that allows consumers and carers to understand the intent that underlies each particular action within the standard. So we will be developing a comprehensive range of resources, and those resources will be available to each of the particular groups who have an interest in the standards. Andrew?
That's it for questions that have been put in chat, and I can't see any hands up. We do have a few minutes left in the time, so if anybody wanted to either put something into chat or turn their video and microphone on, they could jump in, maybe wave at us.
I think there is a question from Carmel in there.
Oh, Lord, sorry.
I'm happy to read it out if you wish.
Yep. Thanks, Carmel. Yeah.
Thanks, David, for the presentation. It was great. So you've said that not all actions apply to all CMOs, depending on size and scope of practice, which is, yes, I guess, self-evident given the number of actions. But just who determines which actions are applicable to a CMO? I mean, I assume if a CMO is going through the process of working through the actions, they could do that for themselves. But if they're wishing to be accredited, who would make that decision as to which actions are applicable? Would it be the accreditation agency? And who do you envisage might be doing this accreditation process? That would also be helpful to know. I think that was another question in the chat function from Audrey.
Understood. So it's important to say that the implementation and scheme arrangements haven't been finalised yet. So as indicated very early on in the presentation, we anticipate that will take probably another 9 to 12 months after we publish the standards, and therefore we don't anticipate the standards being operational until the start of 2023. But to give you sort of a guidepost answer to that particular question, the individual agency itself in the first instance would indicate that they don't think a particular standard applies, and they provide a rationale regarding that to the accreditation agency. We would provide the accreditation agency guiding material that assists them to understand how to interpret the standards and how to apply them in particular circumstances. And we would, of course, train those particular agencies so that they had an understanding of the intention of the standards and how they ought to apply across the range of services that make up the CMO sector. And then the determination would be made between the agency being accredited and the accrediting agency who is assessing them determine whether a particular action applied. But that's in broad terms. Of course, we have to specify that and get down to putting the detail into documentation.
No, that's helpful. Thanks, David.
No problem at all.
Okay. And David and everybody else, my apologies. I haven't monitored the chat before, and I didn't know the scroll bar. Anyway, Shandy Arledge, who has put her hand up but also asked a question around the language of recovery-oriented services and trauma-informed care. Shandy, do you want to speak to that?
Sure. Yeah, thank you. Thanks, David. Thanks, Andrew, and all the team, actually, for the work that you put into this. I guess when I read document, I don't see reference specifically to trauma-informed care and support, and I don't see the or the term recovery-oriented supports and services in the document. Is there a reason why they're not there?
No particular reason that the terminology is not there, other than perhaps that the individual concepts could be covered by language in the standards that is there, and therefore the particular way of applying the themes that you've just described can be picked up by the resources. I think it would be fair to say that we've tried where we can to make the language of the individual actions visible to some of the other sets of standards that exist out there in the system, to focus on being able to achieve the sort of mutual recognition outcomes that we'd hoped for. So if we've missed an opportunity to get the language that you described in a place where you think it belongs, we're more than happy to hear that, such that we can frame the language that exists within the standards in a way that perhaps is more helpful. We have, as I said, we do have two options for handling that though. We can do that by putting the language specifically in a standard, or we can put it into the supporting resources that allow an assessing agency to understand how to apply a given action in a given circumstance. Either of those options can be used.
Yeah, I think that they're both evidence-based and commonly used terms, and I think they probably apply, they could apply in other standards as well, really. So I think maybe it's something that I'll take up in the focus group.
Absolutely.
And think a little bit more about where it actually fits, because I could see as I was reading through them that, you know, I could see that there were sort of angles heading in those directions in the way things were written. But particularly with trauma-informed care and support, I think it's really good to be really explicit about that, because of, you know, the human rights angles and the agency angles and those kinds of things, and the actual experience that a person feels and has as they go into services. So yeah, I'll take it up in more detail in the focus group, David.
No problem, Shandy. Thank you for the point.
Okay.
Yep.
Got a couple here. And everyone's asking all the tricky ones right from the get-go. Will the commission be, this is Elena Slodecki, will the commission be providing a list of the mutually recognisable standards, or will the onus be on individual CMOs, commission agreement between organisations responsible for different sets of standards, for instance, between the commission and...
So I have to caveat the answer I'm about to give by saying that we haven't finalised the arrangements with the various bodies responsible for the individual sets of standards. But the way that would generally work is that the organisations who are responsible for the standards would agree where they think a particular standard has an equivalency between the two organisations. And then they would publish that for the benefit of the agencies being accredited. So to give you an example, if we were to look at mutual recognition with, say, the NDIS practice standards, the Commission and the NDIS Quality and Safeguards Commission would sit down and agree in terms of a mapping arrangement which sets of standards in each document have an equivalency, and then publish that for the benefit of agencies being accredited so they knew which ones applied and which ones perhaps don't. I just again have to reinforce, though, that we haven't gone through that process yet, and I don't have any detail to provide you about what standards might map to each other at this point, or indeed how that might look at the end of a process.
Okay. Kevin Jen has commented that the standard makes a cursory reference to medication safety, and asked, will it link to the medication safety standard?
Again, I missed the end of your question there, Andrew, but to say that that the actions contained in the medication safety criteria that sits under the model of care standard in the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs, those actions are drawn from the National Safety and Quality Health Services Standard on Medication Safety. It doesn't capture all of the items under the National Safety and Quality Health Service Standards Medication Safety Standard, because many of them were deemed not to be necessarily applicable in a CMO setting. But nonetheless, they do have an interrelationship conceptually, and the actions that exist within the National Safety and Quality Mental Health Standards for CMOs are also visible in the National Safety and Quality Health Service Standards. I hope that answers the question. I did miss the final connection point in Andrew's question, but I hope that answers it.
Alison Birch has asked, will implementation guides for different types of CMO be developed?
I guess that's something we'd be keen to get feedback on from all of you about what the delineations might need to be across the various service types in the CMO sector. One thing we were conscious of in the development process is that the CMO sector, while there are some definitions out there of the range of services drawn from work done by the MHCC and also by Community Mental Health Australia, the range of services being provided by CMOs is changing and adapting all the time. So we would be keen to get feedback on how much that delineation needs to be visible between various different types of services to ensure that we map appropriately the advice that we give you on how to implement services, accepting that different types of services may have different needs. We would certainly give guidance to assessing agencies, and so you can rest assured that we would give guidance to assessing agencies in terms of how to measure particular implementation approaches across different service types. Andrew?
So Bill Guy, who must be able to type faster than a teenager on chat function, has written something of an essay and says that he'll talk to it more in the feedback sessions. But talking around that there's a sort of risk focus on these standards, a focus on preventing things going wrong rather than a strengths focus, and looking at, you know, building on people's strengths, and wondering whether these can be nudged in a direction more towards strengths focus rather than risk focus. Bill, I don't know. I mean, we do have a couple of minutes. If you want to have a quick, if you want to expand on that now, you probably can with the broader group, but also.
Very quickly, Andrew, and apologies again about that length of that essay.
I'm amazed.
I couldn't help myself, and you're right, it's probably something more correctly to bring up in the focus groups. I totally get this is more primarily focused on information, and also I did premise that by acknowledging and thanking you guys for the incorporation I can see of much of the feedback up to this stage and where we've come. So I want to lead with a positive as always, and it's an initial impression, and as David said, I haven't had an opportunity to go through it in the minute way I would like to do so. But my impression was that, worked in the CMO sector for a long time, there's a sense of it being focused on the management of risk, and I totally get that. But these standards become guidelines that do shape the direction and culture of organizations. And so there is a sense of it focusing specifically on risk. And it's not so much a strengths-based approach as in the way that you deal with a person, but what I mean is that an organization to focus on looking for opportunities and novel and flexible ways of innovating in their recovery approaches. And that's what I meant by that sense of excessive or focus on risk. There is mention of outcomes, and of course we can elaborate upon this, and I guess I don't need to turn this into a question. Maybe in our submission we can suggest what might be some small additions that could be made that might redress the balance, so that there was that also significant focus on organizations focusing on taking opportunities to find new and innovative and local ways for healing and recovery, as well as just managing what could go wrong. Thanks.
We'd certainly be happy to receive your suggestions, Bill. I think obviously the Commission looks at both the safety and the quality components of what happens in service delivery, and in the safety element of things, there is of course a requirement to ensure that the risks identified and managed within the organisational structures, but we hope that we've equally focused on the quality elements and the positive sides of those quality elements in the design of services and the way that services integrate and innovate and do the sort of things that we'd both like to see them do. So, when you've collected your thoughts on the document and given us some feedback, I'm more than happy to look at the balance of those things to see if we've got that balance right and to hear any suggestions you've got about how we can improve it. Andrew.
So we have a couple of people, a few people agreeing with Bill's comments. Vanessa Latham saying she agrees and it has become strengths focused. Belinda Fewings commenting that concerns around the language of predicting risk, particularly with some of the risks inherent in those predictive processes, including a risk that services may not choose to support people who fall into the risk category. Corinne Henderson has flagged that the use of the concept of dignity of risk is missing, and that may be helpful. And Jane, so I think all of those comments, unless people want to jump in and say something further to those comments, Belinda or Corinne or... they're all sort of concurring.
Yeah, I think
somebody's asked when the consultation ends. We'll just remind people, January the 21st. So whenever you're taking your holidays, whether it's December or January, you should have capacity, hopefully, to have a think about these and provide your feedback.
Yes, as Andrew says, we're genuinely keen to get your feedback. We've opened the consultation for an extended period of time to make sure that everybody has the opportunity to provide us with feedback. As I said back in April, we're very, very keen to get this right. So we're more than happy to take the time to get it correct and to hear your views as part of that process.
James is asking when the standards themselves might be finalised. And I think we're aiming to have a version out in the middle of next year, depending on how we can incorporate the feedback from this consultation. I don't know anyone, if we've got veterans from the National Standards for Mental Health Services, which was legendarily 4 years, we're hoping not to have a 4-year process. So mid-2022 for the standards themselves, and then 2023 for the resources and information about implementation to support them. It's always a balance between, you know, getting something out there and getting it right.
Indeed. Any other questions, Andrew? Or
no, I think we've reached the end.
Okay.
Obviously, if people feel they want to talk more, we've got a whole bunch of focus groups coming up. Hopefully, you're already registered. And that will provide opportunity because they're much shorter information there, but good, plenty of time to share thoughts.
Yeah, I just reiterate Andrew's comments, but please have a look at the website, have a look at the opportunities to participate in focus groups, and please do join us for one or more of those groups to give us your thoughts and ensure that we get this correct. I appreciate you very much giving us some time this afternoon to hear what we've had to say, to have a look at the standards. I'm really looking forward to what you have to say when you've had a chance to go through the document in full. Thank you, everyone, and I'll look forward to hearing more from you as the process unfolds. Thanks, everyone.